I'd like for you to turn in the Bibles for a few minutes to the second chapter of Acts. I know that we have other meetings today, and they mean so much, and they're important. And so we're going to try to get right in to talking about a church with a victory. A church with a victory. Now, while you're trying to turn to Acts chapter 2, let me ask you a question. If you could be a member of any local church anytime, which one would be your choice? Which one would be your choice? Would you want to join one that is comparable, self-serving, self-contained, ingrown, obligation shunned? Well, there's a lot of churches out there. They call themselves churches, and they fit right within this category. But I want to look today at the church in the first century. And Chapter 2, and start for reading verse 41. Let's start with verse 41. If you'd stand for the reading of God's word, God help us today. Give us strength. Give us the anointing that we need to put across the word with clear understanding. And I pray as the word go forth, there will be deliverance. There will be healing. And Lord, you'll raise us up to sit in heavenly places. We pray, God, that the Spirit of God will permeate this place as it already has, in Jesus' name. Amen. In Acts chapter 2, starting with verse 41, then those who gladly received his word were baptized. And that day about 3,000 souls were added to the church. And they continued steadfast in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread and in prayer. And fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now all who believed were together, and they had all things in common, and they sold their possessions and goods and divided them among all as everyone had need. So continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, and they ate their food with gladness and simplicity of heart, praising God and having favor with all the people. And the Lord added to the church daily those who were to be saved. Amen?
Amen.
Now I want you to turn in your Bibles to Acts chapter 11. Acts chapter 11 and verses starting with verse 19. They'll have it published for you. Acts chapter 11, verse 19. Now those who were scattered after the persecution that arose over Stephen traveled as far as Phoenicia, Cyprus, and Antioch, preaching the word to no one but the Jews only. But some of them were men from Cyprus and Cyrene, who when they had come to Antioch, spoke to the Hellenists, preaching the Lord Jesus. And the hand of the Lord was with them, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord.
Amen.
Then news of these came to the ear of the church in Jerusalem, and they sent out Barnabas to go as far as Antioch. And when he came, he had seen the grace of God, and he was glad and encouraged them all that with purpose of heart they should continue with the Lord. And he was a good man, full of the Holy Spirit and faith. And a great many people were added to the Lord. Then Barnabas departed for Tarsus to seek Saul. And we had found him, he brought him to Antioch. So it was that for a whole year they assembled with the church and taught a great many people, and the disciples were first called Christians in Antioch. May the Lord bless the reading of his holy word. Amen?
Amen.
You may be seated. As we look at the church in Antioch, in Syria, the scripture really does not give us a great deal of information concerning this local church. We know that the number of converts at Antioch caused the Jerusalem church, or called Cleveland, Tennessee, to send down the bishop. You get that? As an observer, Barnabas, to see what was happening. That's in Acts chapter 11 I read to you. And it was here at Antioch that the disciples of Christ were first called
Christian.
Amen? Also, it was at this church that the Holy Spirit spoke to the church. Said, I want Barnabas and Paul to separate and go on the first missionary journey. This is in Acts chapter 13. I don't know about you, but I would say that this church at Antioch paid the same price that the church paid at Jerusalem. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. At headquarters. I believe, amen, they paid the same price because the Holy Spirit was there directing them as he directed the church at Jerusalem. Amen?
Amen.
It, to me, I don't know, as I was studying this particular passage of scripture and the church and the first century church, I came to the conclusion that these churches was the church with the victory. Now, not to say that there was a problem in time you got human beings on the face of the earth. Amen. You're going to have some misunderstanding, Brother Cloud. Amen. You're going to have, amen, some shortcomings. You're going to have, amen, a little disagreement. But yet, in all of this, they were a church, amen, with the victory. I don't know about you, but that's the kind of church that I want to belong to. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah. Well, Pastor, I heard you say that's the kind of church, but could you call out some things, some other things that cause you to want to belong and become a member of this church?
Amen.
First of all, we want to look at the unity.
Amen.
Wow. That's it. That's hitting the ground running. When you talk about unity, you're talking about maturity. You're talking about the church growing spiritually. Not so much in number, but spiritually. When you talk about, amen, being one and one accord, amen, you're talking about growing up, amen, in the church, amen? Hallelujah. Amen. Everyone's mind, in other words, was centered around and on Jesus.
Amen.
Can you say amen?
Amen.
As you study the book of Acts, you'll find out that their minds was on Jesus. That doesn't mean they didn't have different personalities, different dispositions, different cultures, but their mind was on Jesus. I heard the sister say when she entered the door, amen, we need to be in one accord in our minds and hearts to be on worship and on Jesus. Hallelujah. In other words, no one had any theory that he or she wanted to pull over on somebody. Come on, somebody. Amen. Everybody's mind was on Jesus. They continued to testify. Hallelujah. To the resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. In other words, what I'm trying to say, it was all about Jesus. Hallelujah. 1 through 4, how they were on one accord.
Amen.
Also, now I'm going to explain myself here a little bit.
Go ahead.
They had all things common.
Uh-huh.
Or, here, in other words, what this is saying here is that they were together and had everything in common. In other words, they were unselfish. They shared their joy. They shared their trials and their tribulation. They shared their sorrow. They shared all things. Amen. Whether one member suffered, all the members suffered with it. Or one member was honored, all members rejoiced with it. There were no division in the body. The body was one unit. Though it was made up of many parts, it was one unit. Oh God, help us today. Hallelujah, to be that one unit. Hallelujah. You see, they worked and worshiped in harmony. In harmony. Hallelujah. You see, nowadays, everybody sort of want to do their own thing. They have their own agenda. But I'm going to tell you, my friend, God can't bless through that man. Oh, we have to, we need to. Oh, my God, I wish I had some time. We need to, amen, find out our calling and what God, how God has gifted us that we might fit into the body of Christ where we ought to be and be faithful. Hallelujah. 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 Praise God. We honored our sister back there, Sister Connie. I've never heard her in all the years I've been her pastor saying she wanted to be anyone else other than what God has called her to be. Hallelujah. Praise God. She knew, amen, 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 how God had called and placed a calling and anointing upon her life. And she didn't have to be jealous or concerned about anybody else. Hallelujah. She was obedient to God. That's the reason we honor her today. Hallelujah. Not only, amen, did that first church have unity. Not only did they have things in common. Amen, but they had great power. They had great power, excellent power, divine power, mighty power. In other words, in Mark chapter 16, we talked about it Wednesday night. The Bible says that signs will follow believers. And these signs shall follow them that believe. And in my name shall they cast out devils or demons. They shall speak with new tongues. And oh yes, my friend. And if they take up serpents, and if they drink any deadly thing, it shall not hurt them. And amen, praise God, they shall lay hands on the sick, and they shall recover. Can you say amen? You see, after the day of Pentecost, signs did follow believers, amen. The sick were healed. In Acts chapter 3, the lame man that sat at the gate, amen, amen, and he was lame and could not walk. He was healed in the name of Jesus. Hallelujah. Praise God. The men and women were convicted of their sin. Peter preached with power, and they asked them, what must we do to be saved? What shall we do? Brothers and sisters, God has not limited the power of the church in any age. We today can have that same power if we pray and pay the price. Hallelujah. We can have that same power. Hallelujah. If we pay the same price. Amen. They were in prayer and supplication. Amen. Hallelujah. They knew that they were in spiritual warfare. Hallelujah, because the Bible says in Ephesians chapter 6, verse 12, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and against powers, against rulers of the darkness. And amen, in the spiritual wickedness, the world of spiritual wickedness, and they had power. Also, not only did they have power, they had things in common, they had unity. But I want to look at the church and how they progress. The church of the victory is going to grow. You hear what I'm saying? It's going to grow both spiritually and numerically. It's going to grow. Any church with the victory will be progressive. The very church, or the very day, talking about the Jerusalem church now. The very day the church was filled with the Spirit, 3,000 souls were saved and added to the church. That's in Acts chapter 2, verse 47. The Lord added to the church daily in Acts chapter 4. The church grew, amen, and 5,000 were added in Acts chapter 5, verse 14. And there were even added more in Acts chapter 6. Amen. And then a number of disciples was increasing in Acts chapter 6. Amen. And they increased so rapidly in the church until they stopped counting. Couldn't keep up. They stopped counting. The Bible said a large number of priests became obedient to the faith. Hallelujah.